تِلْكَ آيَاتُ اللَّهِ نَتْلُوهَا عَلَيْكَ بِالْحَقِّ وَمَا اللَّهُ يُرِيدُ ظُلْمًا لِلْعَالَمِينَ
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على الأشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا وحبيبنا مولانا سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد فاتي لما أغلق خاتم لما سبق الناس الحق بالحق وهادي لصراط المستقيم وعلى آله حق قدره ومقداره العظيم اللهم لا علم إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت عليم حكيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم اجعلنا من المخلصين اللهم اجعلنا من المخلصين اللهم اجعلنا من المخلصين ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Alhamdulillah, I thank the community for inviting me out tonight just to share some thoughts with you on this topic. I was just mentioning to Qari Omar when I came in, I actually left all of my notes at Zaytuna. So Alhamdulillah, we'll see what Allah gives. Akhir makhtar of Allah, the best is what Allah chooses. So, I've been asked to speak about this topic of the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah and the benefits or the virtues in these days. And before we talk about the actual days here, I want to just speak about something else first, and which is actually a prelude to that. This time of the year, for me, is incredibly special because, you know, little did I know, I actually took my shahada a few days before the Arafah, Yom al-Arafah. And I remember going to the khutbah. I took my shahada on a Friday, on a Thursday, which was actually Friday night, so it was after right at Maghrib. In South Africa, and I remember going to the khutbah the next day, and the imam said, you know, that there is this day coming up, and if you fast this day, then Allah will forgive your sins for the year past and the year forward. And for me, it was like I won the spiritual lottery. You know, there is many things that I did in my life, we will say that were not halal, you know, prior to being Muslim, obviously. And to hear that, what it really was like, wow, everything that you have done, think about that for one moment, just think about it. What you have done. And as mashallah, Qari Omar just read as well too, and not only that, from his infinite mercy, in his infinite giving, that yubaddilu sayyinat hasana, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changes those bad deeds into good deeds for us. So imagine you have a debt to someone. And then you pay them the debt back, and then they give you money back for paying them the debt back. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's our relationship with Him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as I said before, I wanted to get into the hadith and the a'mal you know, what is recommended in some of these days and what is suggested from some of our books in here. You know, someone was asking me, you know, what is the first thing, what should we do? What should we do in this month? And really, you know, I last weekend I was able to get away for a couple of days. It was one of those like, you know, dream weekends. It was my birthday. I got up, took my backpack, and I got in a tent, and I went about 10,000 feet up on the side of a mountain, and no one was there except for myself, and I spent a few days by myself up there, and I had a lot of time to think. And I was thinking about this topic a little bit of why, you know, what is the first thing that we should do? And I feel that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired me with this thought that it's not about what the first thing that we should do, but it's really about what's the first thing that we should believe. Because the first thing that we have to believe in is the irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the will and the decree. Because I was thinking about it in context of what's happening in the world right now. And it made me think about the hikmah of reading Surah Al-Kahf every week. That we have the story of Musa and Khidr to remind us over and over and over and over again each week that regardless of what you are seeing in the outward world, that there is a reality that exists with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is the truth. And that is the truth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what that truth is, irrespective of what we are seeing from a zahir, from the outward manifestations of this. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before we even begin on these endeavors, before we even begin on these things, that the first thing that we do is to look and become and return to being people that affirm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and foremost is in control of everything. Every animate and inanimate object, that every decision that is being made has to be understood in the context that, as the Shaykh Mashallah read in here, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want any oppression for this world. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only wants good for His servants. So how do we reconcile that with what we're seeing in the world? It's now no longer an exercise in rational thought. It's an exercise in Iman. It's an exercise in Iman. And the place where it becomes problematic for us is when we are looking for the ultimate justice in this world. When we're looking for the ultimate pleasures in this world. When we're looking for all of the ease and satisfaction in this world. If that's the case, then we haven't understood the Quran. Nor have we understood the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. We are going to test you, Allah says, with Noon Thaqeel. He says, we are going to test you. And we are being tested as a ummah. Not only is it bad enough what we're seeing right now, but again today you saw perhaps the accident that happened in Mecca with one of the cranes collapsed and killed some of the people that are arriving for the Hajj. But again, how do we understand this in the context that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only wants good for His servants? This is our challenge. And this is where the rational thought ends, where the intellect ends, and the Iman begins. And the Iman begins. Just like when it's giving, when we're asked to give, it's not about how much is in the bank account, it's about how much Iman is in the heart. Does it matter the amount of money we have in our banks? It's the amount of Iman that we have in our hearts. May Allah increase us in that. Allahumma ameen. The Prophet ﷺ said that at the end of time, to hold on to your deen will be like to hold on to al-jamr al-qabla al-deen fi akhir zamani qabla al-hamr al-jamra. To hold on to your deen in the end of time, he said, will be like to hold on to a red coal in your hand. Those of you that have been camping, that have been around a fire, sometimes you can't even put your hands close to it, away from the fire, because the heat is too intense. Imagine you had to hold on to that. That's what the Prophet ﷺ was saying. So that's what I meant when I said that if we are thinking it's going to be some sort of ease and some sort of ride, that is going to be, you know, flower petals in front of us and alhamdulillah, it's going to be great, then we haven't read the Quran properly and understood it, and we haven't read it. But here's the thing. Here's the reality. A jaza min jins mushaqqa. the Prophet also said, that our reward is commensurate to the hardship that you face. Allah is too just. Allah is too generous. So may Allah make us of those people, alhamdulillah, that we are people that affirm the yaqeen, that affirm and have yaqeen in the promises of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what He has mentioned. We have come into the days, or we are approaching the days, mashallah, of the Dhul Hijjah. And as we approach these days, that one of the things that we could think about here in this idea of yaqeen is that Imam Haddad, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says that I give you counsel that you must strengthen your certainty. I give you counsel that you must strengthen your certainty. And he says that certainty derives its power and excellence from many things. And you as an individual, you have to determine what that thing is for you. As an individual. It may be the ayat of Jannah, and that's what motivates you and gives you that yaqeen. It may be the wa'id, it may be the threats that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has from the nar. That may be the thing that increases your yaqeen. Allah ta'ala, Allah knows what it is, but for you to establish it is for you to begin that relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Quran talks about it over and over again and gives us different ways in which to engage with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But as we talk about this and we talk about these days, why are we here right now? We're here because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that إِنَّ عِنْدَ الْشُهُورِ عِنْدُ اللَّهِ إِثْنَ عَشْرَ شَهْرًا فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْعَرْضِ مِنْهَا أَرْبَعَةٌ حُرُمٌ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we are here, why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, from the time that He created the heavens and the earth, that He has 4 months, He has 12 months in the year. And of those 12 months, 4 of them are sacred. And of those 4 months that are sacred, one of them is more sacred, which is the Dhul Hijjah. The 4 months are Rajab, Dhul Qa'da, the month that we are in right now, Dhul Hijjah, and Muharram. These are the 4 months that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned, that these are the months that are sacred and they are different from the other months of the year. I won't go into the history of that, but suffice to say that these months are sacred to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then within that, one of those 4 months is more sacred than the others. And then within that month, there are days that are more sacred than the other. And then in those days, there is one day that is more sacred than those 10. So in the month, the first 10 days are more sacred in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as they concern us. So we have the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And that one day is Arafah, that is more sacred than any of those days. And we'll talk about that a little bit. So when we get into this idea here and we begin to talk about it, where does it come from? MashaAllah, Qari Allah read it in the first Raka'ah. Wal Fajr, wa layal al Ashr. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking qasam, wal fajr, right? He's taking qasam with the fajr, wal layal al ashr, and with the 10 and the 10 nights here, which actually is talked about when you talk about the tafsir of Ibn Abbas and others talk about it as being the 10 days of this. Ibn Abbas says ayyam al ashr. So here we have these 10 days. So let's look at this hadith. خرج البخاري في الحديث ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال that the Imam Bukhari has a hadith of Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, in which he says, the Prophet ﷺ has said, مَا مِنْ أَيَّامِ الْعَمَلُ صَالِحُ فِيهَا أَحَبَّ إِلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ هَذِي أَيَّامِ يعني أيام العشر. So, the Prophet ﷺ said that there is not a day in which أَعْمَالُ صَالِحُ, that righteous actions in it are more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than these days. So again, this goes back to that point then about how much of this do we believe? Right? And then how much of it do we believe? And how much of it do we have yaqeen? Because to believe in it will be one thing, to have yaqeen in it will determine whether or not we are going to act accordingly in those days. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has 4 months that are different than the other eight, and he has 1 month that is different than those other four, and he has 10 days that are different than the other 30, 20 that are in that month, then what do you think he's trying to tell you? Get to work. Get to work, because I have flung open the doors of my treasure chest. I have flung open the doors of my treasure chest for these days and for these nights. And they are not like any other days, nor are they like any other nights. And we'll read some of the hadith here now. But it's a two-way street. We forget that at times. Just like being in Mecca, we like to mention, mashallah, that the amal is 100,000 rewards, but also the sins are 100,000 as well too. So this is something that we have to be thinking about in these days. These days and nights are not like the other days and nights. As we approach this, the Hijjah. So what are some of the things that we talk about here? Some of the scholars said, أيام العشر ذي الحجة أفضل أيام وليال عشرة أواخر من رمضان أفضل أيام. So he says that the idea here, some of the scholars have said, most of the scholars adopt the opinion that these days are better than the last 10 days of Ramadan. However, they hold that the last 10 days of Ramadan at a higher status because Laylatul Qadr is in it. But their nights are better, and there's no difference in opinion in that. So the days. And now this goes back to what some of the scholars have also said, that worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the days of Dhul Hijjah are difficult, more difficult than worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the days of Ramadan. What might be a reason for that? What might be a reason for that? There are three things normally that scholars warn us about. They warn us about the nafs, they warn us about hawa, I'm sorry, they warn us about the nafs, the shaitan, and the dunya. Right? Three things normally that scholars, when they're talking about tazkiyah, we're talking about us purifying ourselves. There are three things normally they warn us about: our own selves, our own inclinations, those things, the lower things that we are inclined towards. That's one of the things that they warn us of. Another thing they warn us of is this dunya. Of this dunya. And mashallah, I heard Shaykh Hamza mentioning something really interesting about dunya the other day that made me think a little bit different. Dunya is from dana in Arabic, meaning something which is low. In the surah, we have qutufu hadaniya, right? Allah is talking about the fruit of Jannah, that it's actually, it will be low hanging. Qutufu hadaniya. Its fruit will be low hanging in the Jannah. May Allah allow us to eat from that fruit. Allahumma ameen.
Ameen.
But dunya also has a meaning that it is something that you reach out for, it is close to you, but you reach out for it, but you never can take it. You never can catch it. And I remember Shaykh Tawfiq al-Bulti, Hafidhullah Ta'ala, he's the son of Shaykh Bulti, Rahimullah, and we used to pray in their masjid. I lived right next to their masjid when I lived in Damascus for some time. And one morning he said, I'm going to give you a dars on the dunya. He said, are you ready? He said, sure. So he reached out his hand like this, and he opened it up, He said, this is the dunya. The dars is finished. So this is this dunya that we are warned about, these things that we will constantly be reaching for that we'll never be able to achieve. But Shaykh Hamza said something very different. He said, which is different than the alam. He said the dunya is very different than from the alam, from this the physical world that we are in. The physical world is the beauty of the mountains that we see and the sunset and the skies and these types of things. And there's nothing blameworthy of, alhamdulillah, longing for those things and having the jamal, the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creative ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be filled in your heart through those things. But don't get it confused with the dunya. Because that's not coming with us. And those things are going to endure far beyond after we are here. But back to these points here. One of the scholars has said, "Tudha'afu fiha hasanatu qala ibn Abbas al-amalu fihi bi 700 da'af." That one of the scholars said the rewards are multiplied in these days, and Ibn Abbas is recorded to have said that the reward for good deeds in these days are multiplied 700 times. 700 times. Imagine you came to work. You know where I'm going with this, right? I'm going to make your salary 700 times it is for this month. And if you work overtime, time and a half, what do you think would happen to us? Who wouldn't be at home for that month? Tell the wife, khalas, I'm bringing the sleeping bag to the office. I'll be done in a month, inshallah ta'ala. But we'll work towards it. And it made me reminded me of the time when one of our sheikhs said, he said, you know, a lot of people were complaining, you know, there was a time, remember, that dhikr beads were bid'ah, and people shouldn't be using them and these types of things. He said, but I'll tell you what. He said, imagine that every time that you made dhikr on one of these things that a $10 bill fell from the ceiling. He said, you'd have the dhikr beads of 10,000 long, you'd give one to each kid and your wife, tell them don't go to sleep until you make your 10,000 tasbih. Right? Because now we have Ayn al-Yaqeen. We see the $10 dropping down every time. But what about the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promising us that, or from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And maybe the hadith is da'if. Maybe the hadith is da'if. Wait, maybe it is. But what is the blameworthy? What is it? Imam Ahmed, others, all of them said that it is fine to take from hadith or da'if for fada'a. When you're encouraging people to do actions that are good, it is okay to take from the hadith that are da'if. All of the ulama agree upon this point. Except for that they cannot be used for aqidah, and they cannot be used for the law. For fiqh. And one of my teachers in Damascus, he said, this is how, Dawood, I understand hadith that are da'if. He said, it's like this. Your mother is traveling. And you get a phone call, your brother answers the phone, and he tells you, subhanAllah, inshallah, our mother is coming back, and I can't remember if she told me the flight is on Monday or Tuesday. He said, would you not go to the airport on Monday? You're not certain, right? But it could be on Monday. He said, like this, a hadith which is da'if. It may be correct, it may not be correct. What have you lost if you act upon that hadith? Nothing. But what have you gained if it is true? 700 times for your deeds. 700 times for your deeds. May Allah make us of those people. مَا مِنْ أَيَّامِ الْعَمَلُ فِيهَا أَفْضَلُ مِنْ أَيَّامِ الْعَشْرِ. That another hadith, so one is that their most, your actions in it are most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this hadith, there are no days in which the actions in it are better than the days of the 10 of Dhul Hijjah. So you have one that says that the actions in it are most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you have another hadith which says that there are no days that the actions in those days are better than any of these, than the 10 days of the Hijjah. MashaAllah. MashaAllah. I think if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens up for us this understanding, and honestly, I, uh, alhamdulillah, this is I have a copy of this book, but I don't have my copy. It's not with me. This is Imam Zaid's copy. And I remember in Damascus in the late 90s, we were reading this book with him. So alhamdulillah, it has his notes in it, and I feel blessed to be able to sit here and read from it. Alhamdulillah. But my question, my reminder to myself is that I have heard these hadith before. And I've sat in circles when they are discussed and when the commentary is mentioned on them, for years perhaps. But it's been some time since I went through and read it for myself. And I can tell you honestly, from Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, I was reading through this book. And I cannot tell you what it has done to increase my iman and my yaqeen and my longing for these 10 days. So my advice is, look for something, inshallah ta'ala, that you are going to take from understanding that these days are not like any other days. And how will you show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you believe that these days are not like other days? And inshallah ta'ala, those are the things that we can discuss right now. This one other hadith that the Prophet says, and again, the hadith is mentioned that it's da'if. And Imam Tirmidhi and Imam Bukhari also mentioned that the isnad. So you have now, the isnad is mentioned as being weak, but not the nas, not the text itself, not the words itself, but the train of transmission. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. He says, the Prophet said, ما من أيام أحب إلى الله أن يتعبد له فيها من عشر ذي الحجة يعدل صيام كل سنة منها بصيام سنة وقيام كل ليلة منها بقيام ليلة القدر. He says that there are no days that are better, more beloved, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worshipped than these days of Dhul Hijjah. Fasting in one of these days is equal to fasting an entire year. And standing in Qiyam in one of these nights is like standing for Laylatul Qadr. May Allah give us that reality. May Allah give us that reality. Just the fact that we are longing for that, that's what we're thinking about, that's what's making us concerned. Okay, I need to go to bed earlier tonight because I want to get up to be able to make that qiyam. I want to ensure that, you know, the things are ready and the things are there because I want to fast, you know, during these days. So these are just, you know, some of the things, inshallah ta'ala, that we'll mention here, that, you know, what is a plan, inshallah ta'ala, that we can have for these 10 days here. The first is really, you know, as I said here, to feel that we are blessed and realize that this is an opportunity of a lifetime, because none of us know that when we will witness again these 10 days. Right? We don't know. We don't know, I don't know if I'm going to make it to those days. And if I have the niyyah, inshallah ta'ala, that I want to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in those days, like I do, other than I worship Him in other days, then may Allah give us that reality. But we start from here. One of the scholars has said, he said, إِذَا فَتَحَ لِأَحَدِكُمْ إِذَا فُتَحَ لِأَحَدِكُمْ بَابَ الْخَيْرِ فَلْيَسْرِعَ فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَدْرِي مَتَّى يُغْلَقْ عَنْهُ. He says, if a door, this is Khalid bin Mi'dan, who used to say that if the door for good is open for one of you, then rush to take advantage of it, because you don't know when it will close. You don't know when it will close. And that's that whole idea of shaitan, like, you'll do it later. You'll do it later. You'll do it later. And subhanAllah, and I'll share with you, right when I was thinking about taking my shahada, because what happened was I was going to this masjid. I just wanted to sit outside of this masjid and listen to the adhan. That's all I wanted to do. I went there, I sat outside for a while, no one came, the doors were locked. Alhamdulillah. So I left. Came back another week, sat outside, no one came, the doors were locked, I left. Came back a third time, And alhamdulillah, people came. What I realized was that the other times I was going between Asr and Maghrib. So no one was in the masjid. So I made it there, you know, just before Maghrib. And I remember the people were coming into the masjid, and I said to them, you know, do you mind if I just sit here? I was sitting outside on the sidewalk, on the curb. I said, do you mind if I sit here? I just want to sit here. I want to just listen to the call to prayer. And they said, no problem. But why don't you come inside and pray with us? I said, I'm not Muslim. They said, it's okay, no problem. Come inside. So alhamdulillah, I can actually say that I made my first salat in a masjid without wudu. Allah kabul from me. Ameen. May Allah accept. So I prayed with them. And then I had this thought. I said, you know, how come I'm not Muslim? I believe in Allah on the last day. I believe in the Quran. I believe that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a prophet. How come I'm not Muslim? Straight away, shaitan came to me. You're a good person. You love your mother. You don't, you know, harm people. You know, blah, 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 all of these things. The reason why I mention this is because what happened was he convinced me to do it later. He said, think of all the things you're going to lose. I had an apartment in London at that time. I was living in South Africa. I was going to be going back to New York in a couple of months after that. You know, he said, you know, think of all those things you're going to have to give up. You're going to have to stop all those things. I said, yeah, you know, you're right, man. You're right. That's dunya. Yeah. That's dunya. So, but the reality of why I mention this is because then what I came to was in my argument with Shaitan was, I'm going to do it later. I said, I'm going to do it, but I'm going to do it later. That's the whole idea. We don't know. Later is not guaranteed. Later is not guaranteed. So may Allah give us and remind us of that, that later is not guaranteed. And that may, inshallah, we be people, inshallah, that are thinking of this right now. You know, some of the things here that we can think about is, you know, taking advantage of, you know, having changing our aspirations in these days, in the hopes that they will also become habituated, that we will become habituated in these things. You know, how many times have I heard this, but how many times have I slipped on this, and how many times have I lapsed on this? How many of us right now want to have a Hajj that is accepted? I do. I want to have a Hajj right now that is accepted. And how many of you want to have an Umrah that is accepted? I want to have an Umrah right now that is accepted. How many of us can make a Hajj every day? How many of us can make an Umrah every day? Now, so imagine if I asked you, there's the ability for you to make a Hajj every day. And there's the ability for you to make an Umrah every day. Maqboolan inda Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa huwa sadiq al-masduq. And he is the most truthful of those who speak the truth. من صلى الفجر في جماعة ثم قعد يذكر الله حتى تطلع الشمس ثم صلى ركعتين كانت له كالأجر حج والعمرة تامة تامة تامة. How many times have I heard this hadith, Ya Dawood? How many times have I heard this hadith, and how many times have I broken my promise? The Prophet ﷺ said a hadith. Whoever prays Fajr in congregation and then sits and remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until the sun rises, then prays two raka'ats, he has the full reward of a Hajj and an Umrah. He has the full reward of a Hajj and an Umrah. Two raka'ats. Two raka'ats from the Fajr. So this is what I'm talking about for myself. I have time, inshallah, I'll do it later, I'll do it at 10 o'clock, I can't do it right now, I'm rushing out of the house, I don't have a meeting between 10 and 11, I'll knock it out at between 10 and 11. What happens at 10 and 11? You have someone else coming in. So there are times that we had the opportunity to do it, and that's what Shaitan's whole MO is. Right? His whole plan is to get us to not do that thing. And one of the greatest examples, in my opinion, that my teacher gave, he said, this is how Shaitan works. You have a $1 bill in your pocket, and you have a $10 bill in your pocket. And there is someone on the street that is, you know, asking for money, they have a cup in their hand or something. And you stick your hand in your pocket, and you have every intention to give them something. But you don't want to give them the 10. And you don't want to pull out the 10, because that'll be embarrassing, right? You have a 1 and a 10, you pull out $11, you give them 1, you put a 10 back in your pocket, that might be, you know, embarrassing. So what happens is you have the 1 and the 10 in your pocket, and as you go by the person, you go through, try to flip through, 1, 10, 1, 10, you're not sure which one it is, and then you just pass by, you don't give it. That's Shaitan. That's the game of Shaitan in the universe. Right? I'm in a rush right now. How long does it take for me, Dawood, to pray 2 raka'ats? Probably the same amount of time it's going to take to me to think it through of why I'm not praying the 2 raka'ats. So again, these 10 days are there for us. And as the Shaykh had said, right, we don't know, right, إِذَا فُتِحَ لِأَهْلِكُمْ أَبَابُ الْخَيْرِ فَلْيَسْرِعْ. If the doors of good have been opened for you, then rush through them to take advantage of that. And these are the days that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is laying out for us. So alhamdulillah, that's something that we can do, inshaAllah, in these days. So imagine then, you combine that with the hadith that's from Ibn Abbas, narrated from Ibn Abbas, that says that it's 700 times. So imagine you had 700 hajj for the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. I need a mathematician on this one. Can someone help me? 700 times 10. 70,000. MashaAllah.
7,000.
Now, the 7,000 per, it could be 7,000 per day. Could be 70,000 per day, because there's another narration that says, al-ajru al-ashri amthali, o sab'una, o sab'imiyya, o elf, o ila ma sha' Allah. There's another narration that says that rewards are by 10, 70, 700, 1,000, or whatever Allah wills it to be. MashaAllah. And so this is the thing, inshallah ta'ala, that this world, regardless of the state that it looks in, this is the reality that we have, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the opportunity for each day. Each day. So may Allah give us the ability, inshallah ta'ala, to work on these things. One of the things that we may want to look at when thinking about these days is that, you know, we also want to put things into priority. Maybe if there are, you know, we may become engaged in trying to do extra deeds, but the things that are obligatory upon us, maybe those things are not being met. So from the awliya, from the priorities of things, the first thing would be to ensure that the 5 salawat are being prayed and are established in their time. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established these things for us, and that my servant does not draw closer to me to any, with anything more beloved than what I have made obligatory upon him. مَفْرَضُ عَلَيْهِ. Right? My servant does not draw nearer with anything more beloved to me than what I have made obligatory upon him. So the first thing that we should ensure is that those things are established in our lives. Some of the things to think about, obviously then, if we have then agreed or come to this point that these days are different and that I'm going to be different, then perhaps there are things that I can do which are different inside of my life during these days. If I'm not reading the Quran as much, perhaps I may set a goal, but set your goals to be realistic, because this is something else that Shaitan does. He has us set these lofty goals, and then when we can't meet them, then we beat ourselves up. It's another trick that he has. It's called the 90-day burnout for the convert. He has the convert doing everything, tahajjud, four raka'at, two raka'at, right, of fajr, four before, four after, four before asr, you know, two after maghrib, awwab, eight raka'at, 16 raka'at after between maghrib and isha. He prays four before isha, four after isha. Probably handle that for about 90 days, come 90 days. Islam may not be looking so good to that person anymore. Right? So pace ourselves. Pace ourselves. So we don't face that type of burnout. Right? Pace ourselves. So mashallah, some of the other things that we can think about here, obviously we said about Quran, if we could read a khatam in these days, it would be beautiful for us to be able to recite three juz a day, or a little bit more, so you can complete perhaps at 9, or one of my wife's teachers used to actually start and to get 10 days, because the 10th day is actually is Eid, so that you are not fasting on that day. She would start from the day before, from the last day of Dhul-Qa'dah. And that may be something you want to start a khatam in perhaps, and you want 10 days, having the last day of Arafah being that day, or maybe you read 6 on Arafah. Allah knows best. But that's one of the things. And also speaking about Arafah, inshallah, that really looking to nastaghni min al-waqt, that we benefit from the time in Arafah, that in after, between Asr and Maghrib, that we, inshallah ta'ala, are engaged in Salat. Some of the other things, Qiyam al-Layl, right? Looking for again, changing some of the things that we do if we're not making that during this time, that we commit ourselves because these days are better and the treasure chest is open. Alhamdulillah. How are we doing on your time? Yeah. 8:45, stop. Inshallah. So, again, maybe adding some of the extra salat during the day, right? Some of the extra raka'ats. The Prophet has said a hadith that, you know, why fala amal is important, right? Because it doesn't suffice our children when they ask us, you know, why do I pray these? Or why don't we say, well, you just have to pray them? We should know the fala amal. We should be incentivized. If you go to a job, are you not going to be concerned with the salary? Oh, mashallah, I'll take this job. You have no idea what it pays. That's the nature of us on one level of iman. That's one level of iman, that we're looking to get paid for this, right? May Allah increase that iman to the point that whether there's an ajr or whether there's not an ajr, we still worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He is the only one who is worthy to be worshipped. That's Imam Ghazali said that there are three examples in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worshipped. One is that of a slave relationship between a servant and the master. That it is not something, it is only done because the servant is obligated to do it. And as soon as the master is no longer there to oversee that it's being done, they'll stop. May Allah protect us from that. He says then there's another one of the tujjar, of the one who is business transactions, right? What's the best transaction that I can set myself up for? Alhamdulillah. Right? What is the reward? It's so much of this. And what is the reward? It's so much of that. He says, and then the third one is like the man who is free. And it's based purely on love. Regardless if there's a reward or not a reward, they still worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If there's Jannah or Jahannam, doesn't matter to them. They still worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the highest level of iman. May Allah give us a piece of that. But again, increasing our salat during that day, there is not a Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ says in the hadith, there is not a Muslim who prays 12 raka'at per day other than the obligatory prayer, meaning that if you're adding your 2 at Fajr, you're adding say 4 at Dhuhr, you're adding 4 at Asr, you do 2 after Maghrib, say hypothetically that's 12. There is not a Muslim who prays 12 raka'at per day other than the obligatory prayers, except for that a place is built for him in the Jannah. Except for that. And there's another narration that says that when we come with deficiencies in our prayer, in our obligatory prayer, when those are deficient, when they are unacceptable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will order the malaika, will say, yeah, you'll ask the malaika, is there anything, did he pray any nawafil, did he pray any of the sunnah salat? And the angels will reply, yes. And they will say, Allah will say, then take from that to complete the deficiencies. To complete the deficiencies of our obligatory prayers. وَمَا تَوْفِيقِ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. Allah's the one that completes it. Allah's the one that completes it. So alhamdulillah, this idea of Arafah being the best day, I just want to close on this. In Surah Al-Baqarah, we know the 30th ayah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the conversation with the malaika, إِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَ إِنِّي جَعْلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءُ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ قَالَ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the malaika that I will create a representative on the earth, and they said, will you place on this earth someone who will make mischief, who will disobey you and shed blood? And we, the angels, we celebrate you and your praise, and we glorify your name. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun, that I know what you know not. So the scholars have said that on Arafah, that this is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala returned, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this ayah, this last part of it, Inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun, that they will come to me in full obedience. And there's a hadith. I'm going to read this hadith to you. Now, ما من يوم أفضل عند الله من يوم العرفة ينزل الله تبارك وتعالى السماء الدنيا فيباهي بأهل الأرض أهل السماء فيقول انظروا إلى عبادي شعثا غبرا ضاحين جاءون من كل فج عميق يرجون رحمتي ولم يروا عذابي. فَلَمْ يُرَى أَكْثَرُ عَتِيقًا مِنَ النَّارِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْعَرَفَةِ. When the angels said about us that we would only sow corruption in this world and shed blood, Allah says, إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, that Allah is saying that He knows what is the reality inside of every single one of us. And this hadith here in the يَوْمِ الْعَرَفَةِ, that the Prophet ﷺ said that there is no day that is better with regard to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than Yawm al-Arafah. This is qat. Any day. There is no day in any day of the year that is better than the day of Arafah and with regard to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, however He does, descends to the sama'a dunya, to the heavenly sky. And He boasts to the people of, or He boasts to the residents of the sky, the angelic realm, about the people of the earth. And He says, look at my servants, disheveled hair, sha'than, ghubran, covered in dirt, dahina, they are making all sacrifices for me. They have come from every distant place, kulli fajin amit. يَرْجُونَ رَحْمَتِي, all they are desirous of is my mercy. And He says, not only يَرْجُونَ رَحْمَتِي وَلَمْ يَرَوْ عَذَابِي, and they haven't even seen my punishment. They haven't even seen my punishment. What if Allah opened that veil for us and we understood what the reality of that punishment was? We are desirous of His rahmah right now and we are hearing about it. But imagine if He unlifted that veil from us and what that would be like. So and He says that you will never see more people liberated from the fire than the day of Arafah. Allah make us of those people. Allah make us of those people. And I want to close, inshallah ta'ala, with just this line of poetry here. Because the Eid at times becomes this big festive time, mashallah, if we sacrifice for those 10 days, and then the Eid, you know, we should think about it perhaps as this poet mentioned, he said, لَيْسَ الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ لَبِسَ الْجَدِيدُ لَيْسَ الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ لَبِسَ الْجَدِيدُ إِنَّمَا الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ طَاعَتُهُ تَزِيدُ لَيْسَ الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ تَجَمَّلَ بِاللِّبَاسِ وَالْرُكُوبُ إِنَّمَا الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ غَفْرَتْ لَهُ الذُّنُوبُ. This is what we want. He says, لَيْسَ الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ لَبِسَ الْجَدِيدُ. He said, Eid is not for the one who wears new clothes. إِنَّمَا الْعِيدُ Eid is only for the one whose obedience in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases. إِنَّمَا الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ طَعْتُهُ تَزِيدُ. And this is what Ali radiallahu anhu said, Karamallahu wajhu. He said, Kullu yawm yawm wa'id liman ata'a Allah. He said, every day is a day of Eid for the one who is obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make us of those people. And he says that, in closing this last line here, he says the Eid is not about beautifying ourselves and riding and being in our being in the most prominent riding animals or the most prominent vehicles. He says that the Eid, إِنَّمَا الْعِيدُ لِمَنْ غَفْرَتْ لَهُ الذُّنُوبُ غُفْرَتْ لَهُ الذُّنُوبُ عَفْوًا. He says that the Eid is for the one, the celebration, the true celebration, he says, is not just because we have some new clothes and we have, mashallah, a nice vehicle in which we can ride in. He said that the true Eid is for the one whose sins have been forgiven. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow this treasure chest to be cast open for us.
Ameen.
And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us people, inshallah ta'ala, that will run into that treasure chest. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the health. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the support, inshallah ta'ala, to be of those people that will take benefit from these days and these nights of the Hijjah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow every one of us to be there in support for one another, to make dua for one another, inshallah ta'ala. And that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the best in this world and in the next. Allahumma hab al-mu'mineena wal-mu'minat, wal-muslimina wal-muslimat, al-ahya'i minhum wal-amwati, arhamar rahimin. Allahumma taqabbal minna, wa'fu anna, wa'ghfir lana, warhamna anta mawlana, fansurna 'ala al-qawmi al-kafirin. Allahumma اللهم وفقنا بما تحب ما ترضى يا رب العالمين اللهم تقبل منا كل أعمال الصالحة يا رب العالمين يا الله. We ask you to accept all of our actions, يا الله. We ask you to give us tawfiq, يا الله, as we approach these days and these nights, يا الله. We ask you, يا الله, to have mercy upon us. We ask you, ya Allah, for that mercy to be spread on us and on our families and our communities and all that we love and that we care about, ya Allah. We ask you, ya Allah, to enlighten, for your nur, inshallah ta'ala, to be in our eyes and in our hearts and in our minds and in our souls, ya Allah, and make us from that light, ya Allah. We ask you, ya Allah, to give us sincerity, ya Allah. Make us a people of ikhlas, ya Allah. Make us people of ikhlas, ya Allah, in the beginning of the affair, in the middle of the affair, and the end of the affair, ya Allah. We ask you, ya Allah, to purify our intentions, purify our tongues, purify our eyes, purify our ears, purify our hands, purify our hearts, purify our minds, ya Allah, purify our thoughts, ya Allah, so that they may only be pleasing to you, ya Allah. Fill up this house with your worship, ya Allah, because you are the only one that is worthy to be worshipped, ya Allah. La ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayka ya rabbal alamin wa akhi da'wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Ya Allah, we ask you to make our best day our last day when we leave this world to meet you. Wa akhi da'wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.